title, linear, nonlinear damping effects on stability of Poland. So, Anibal, go ahead, please.
So thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I would also acknowledge my co-author, Professor Luongo, that, as you know, cannot be here. So I'm going to talk about linear and nonlinear damping effects on the stability of discrete and continuous circulatory systems. This is the outline of my talk. First, I will discuss some motivation and background. Then I will talk about the classical Ziegler's column. Finally, I will try to conclude with an example on the analogous continuum model of the Ziegler columns, which is the viscoelastic back beam. And then I will draw some conclusion. So let me start about a remark about the classical problem position. So stability in a circulatory system is governed by the presence or the absence of damping. It is well known that in the absence of damping, so when you have an undamped circulatory system, the mechanism who the eigenvalues move on the imaginary axis when the load is increasing, starting from zero. So the stability is lost when the eigenvalues collides and then separates. When mu reaches a critical value, mu c. When a small damping is added to the system, stability is lost through a generic of bifurcation, which occurs when mu is equal to a damped value, mu d. So when it is recognized that in dozens of works in the literature, is that mu d is less than mu c. And this is a paradoxical effect. In particular, we wrote two papers in the last 2 years. The explanation given in the literature is that if you want to catch this phenomenon by using a perturbation method, you have, in the spirit of the Arnold's theory of singularity, start your asymptotic expansion in the correspondence of the critically loaded circulatory system, so when mu is equal to mu c. In this way, you can locally build this surface, which is well known as the Whitney umbrella surface, but you cannot catch what happens on the lower level of this so-called this spiral staircase. So, what we will find in the literature is that due to the singularity, except for an optimal direction in which the damping permits to the load to increase, the critical load jumps down. So we were not completely satisfied by this explanation. In particular, from an engineering point of view, two questions were open. So the first one is, how can a discontinuity manifest itself in a smooth system? The second question is, how can a strictly dissipative damping have a detrimental effect on stability? And we tried to give the two answers to this question. The first one is that you have to change your point of view. In particular, the critical load of the damped system should not be linked to the critical load of the circulatory system. I will tell in another way. It should not be regarded as a perturbation of mu c, but of an unknown mu, which is less than mu c. So I will tell you that when you are in a marginally stable equilibrium, such as this one, you have infinitely configuration of equilibrium. So until the load reaches the mu c value, you have infinitely marginally stable point of equilibrium. When you look at the system at mu c, you have just one point. So we propose to change our point of view. So mu d must be seen as a perturbation of not the unique mu c, but of one unknown, infinitely many mu less than mu c. The answer to the second question is also simple. Is simple because damping can be dissipative, since in non-conservative system you have to project the damping force in a non-orthogonal basis. So the quadratic forms in which the right eigen vectors u depends on mu must be replaced by these bilinear forms in which the v eigen vectors can be rendered the damping force dissipative. And this is explained by these figures, the picture. So according to this idea, if we accept this idea, we develop an asymptotic analysis starting from an unknown undamped system. This is quite classical, so we develop a perturbation method due to small damping of a simple eigenvalue at mu less than mu c. We get the first order sensitivity, which is real due to the fact that the right and the left eigenvectors of a circulatory system are real. And this equation, valid from discrete system and for continuous one, permit us to build the stability region when it is equated to zero. So now we are dealing, this was the background. Now we are dealing with the nonlinear problem. So the question is, does the Ziegler paradox hold in the nonlinear range? And the task is to find if a limit cycle exists and how large it is. So we are trying to discuss instability from an engineering point of view. The first system I'm going to consider is the Ziegler conums, in which this is a well-known system, which in order to derive the equations of motion, we consider exact kinematics. A nonlinear viscoelastic law for the devices. In particular, we add to the linear, to the Ziegler law, the a van der Poel damping type, and we get the third order expanded equations of motion in which this fj function are trilinear vector function which accounts for geometrical nonlinearities, inertial nonlinearities, and nonlinear dampings. I will explain soon why the reason for which I add a van der Poel type damping. These are the classical results of linear stability analysis of the Ziegler conum. In particular, you can see a comparison between the exact solution obtained via the Rutherford criterion compared with the asymptotic one. So this is the critical surface in the load damping parameter plane, linear damping parameter plane, which divides the stable states from the unstable ones. These are the mu isolines. In particular, the black curves are the exact solution. The black curves are the asymptotic solution. The gray ones are the exact solution. We choose two case studies, which are both on the right side of the optimal direction, which is the dashed line in the figure, in the right figure. For these two case studies, we have, for the first, damping which have a strong destabilizing effect. For the second one, we have damping which has moderate destabilizing effect. Now we perform a multiple scale analysis with this rescaling, these time scales and series expansion, we get the perturbation equation. The F4 term, I remember you, that is the van der Poel damping term. This is classical, so we get the generating solution, which depends on a complex amplitude A, capital A, and depends on the right again pairs omega U of this problem. Okay, mu is the mu of the damped system, obviously. At the epsilon order, the solvability calls for the left eigenvectors of the damped system. So the epsilon order solvability furnishes the amplitude complex equation in which you can recognize the presence of the direction of the damping force on the base of the left eigenvectors of the damped system, the coefficient C. H is the coefficient of the projection of the circulatory forces on the base of the left eigenvector of the damped system, and then is the same for the nonlinear terms. So you can get in a standard way the amplitude modulation equations, and you can search for the steady periodic non-trivial solution. And if you look at the amplitude of the steady solution, you will see that it depends on two coefficients, B1 and B2, which depend on the real and imaginary part of the coefficient I defined before. How to relate these with the perturbation of a subcritical circulatory system? In this way. If you have small damping, you can expand, you can evaluate the eigenvector sensitivity. So in this way, the right and left eigenvector of the damped system can be seen for small damping as a perturbation of those of the circulatory system. And you can find that the perturbation is complex. Okay? It is imaginary. So if you substitute these formulas in the epsilon order solvability I showed you before, you can get the amplitude, the real form of amplitude modulation equation, and the steady solution appears now more clear, since you can see that the B1 and B2 coefficient we have before are replaced by their first order correction. I mean, the B1 and B2 evaluated in the critical, in the subcritical circulatory point. And another coefficient appear, N4, which is related to the nonlinear damping. So if you have nonlinear damping equal to zero, van der Poel damping equal to zero, you can recognize that the limit cycle amplitude is large, instead of if you put into the system nonlinear damping, you can recognize that this amplitude is small. So let's give a look to the bifurcation diagrams in the absence of van der Poel damping. And you can see that the first column is the case study 1, the second column is the case study 2. You can see that when the larger is the destabilizing effect of the linear damping, the large is the amplitude of the bifurcation diagrams in the nonlinear, in the postcritical behavior. So I plot the load value versus the maximum amplitude of the motion components, and there is also a comparison between the exact solution, black curve, the asymptotic one, dashed curve, the harmonic balance with the first harmonic, the circles, and the harmonic balance with the first and third harmonic, which are the little triangles. And you can see that also that when linear damping is destabilizing, is more destabilizing, also the third, the harmonic balance with the, in the response, also the third harmonics play an important role. when you add van der Poel term, you can see that in terms of nonlinear damping ratio, amplitude of the limit cycle, and load parameters, you can see that for a fixed modulus of the nonlinear damping ratio and for a varying the angle, the nonlinear damping ratio, you can see that the response can be supercritical or subcritical. And in particular, in the nonlinear damping plane, there exists a straight line which divides the two family. So this is for the case study one. The case study two is quite similar, except for the fact that the subcritical region increases. So there is another kind of paradox. When the linear damping is less destabilizing, the nonlinear one seems to be more destabilizing. Okay. I have no. Okay, so these are other results in which I fixed the nonlinear damping ratio. So these are. This means that the two van der Poel dampers are equal, and I varied the damping modulus. And when the damping modulus is positive, which is the case we are considering, you can see that in the case study one, the OPF is supercritical. In the case study two, the OPF is subcritical. Just a few words on the nonlinear backbeam. We formulate the model by taking as descriptor the rotation of the cross section theta. Formally, the equation of motion appears like in the 2 degree of freedom system. You can recognize the presence of the trilinear function f1, f2, f3, and f4 that in this case are scalar function. Rho is the van der Poel damping. These are the well-known results of the linear stability analysis. This is the Whitney umbrella for the viscoelastic backbeam. These are the two case studies we consider for this system. Different from the 2 degree of freedom system, here the optimal direction coincides with the internal damping equated to zero, so only external damping. Again, we considered in the constitutive behavior van der Poel term, and for we have a similar behavior. So when the van der Poel term is equal to zero, you have large amplitude limit cycle. When in the case study one, when damping is most detrimental with the respect to is more detrimental with the respect to the case study two, we have a supercritical OPF bifurcation for positive rho. In the case study two, we have a subcritical OPF bifurcation. So the conclusion: the mechanical behavior of the nonlinear Ziegler column and the nonlinear viscoelastic backbeam has been analyzed. The destabilization paradox has been explained in a new perspective, and a perturbation method has been consistently developed. The analysis of the nonlinear problem carried out via the multiple scale method reveals the existence of a large amplitude supercritical limit cycle when nonlinear damping is absent. The existence of a small amplitude limit cycle when the system is endowed with proper, in this case, van der Poel type damping, has been discussed via a suitable perturbation from a subcritical state. Finally, it has been shown that nonlinear damping can be beneficial in the sense that it renders supercritical the OPF bifurcation, but it can be also detrimental in the sense that it can render subcritical the same bifurcation, and thus revealing a new aspect of the Ziegler paradox existing also in the nonlinear field. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you for the presentation. We can take one or two questions. Any question? So maybe I have a question. Why you have chosen van der Poel and not another nonlinear damping?
Yes.
What is the reason?
This is like a prototype of damping, since basically we need to have Okay, well, when you evaluate the generating solution and substitute the generating solution in the F4 term at the epsilon order, a van der Poel damping is able to render this term complex, imaginary. Okay? If you add another form of damping, you are not sure of this, so you have to check. It depends on the form of damping you want to add. And so probably you don't have N4 here, okay? So it is a prototype of damping in order to have in this position the nonlinear terms.
Okay, so thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again for presentation.